Welcome to Through the Bible with Les Feldick, a 30-minute walk through the Scriptures, teaching in-depth Bible truths that change people's lives. Now, here's your host, Les Feldick.
Okay, once again, we're ready for program number three, and we always appreciate the fact that you all stay. You know, I think I might be tempted to leave some of these afternoons. But we're glad you're all here in the studio, and for those of you out in television again, we just like to welcome you to an informal Bible study. And we just sort of take most of these things verse by verse and precept upon precept. And I have no agenda. I don't try to grind any axes. I never name names. Maybe some people think I should, but no, I don't want to do that. Because I feel that if I keep teaching what the book says and I stay on the truth, the word will do everything that needs to be done. Now, maybe that's a pacifist approach, but that's what I feel the most comfortable with, is to let the word itself speak. Okay, now, here we're in a beautiful love story between Ruth the Moabitess, out of idolatry, who comes into finally a marriage relationship with a man of Israel, who was the next of kin. He was in a position to redeem the land that had been mortgaged, and that was all according to Israeli law. You couldn't just go in and buy a piece of property and pay the mortgage and go on. It always was according to the inheritances and that it stayed within the family. And so now in the book of Ruth, we're going to continue on, and forgive me if I take pretty much reading it verse by verse. I'll never forget, quite a few years ago, wasn't it, honey? A lady wrote and she said, I'm a Jehovah's Witness, but I love your reading program. So sometimes it doesn't hurt to read, because after all, a lot of people don't. They just don't read. And even if they look at it, they don't read. I'll never forget years back, I was teaching one of my classes here in Oklahoma, and we were just a small group. And I was reading a verse of Scripture, and one of the ladies looked up at me almost in utter shock. And she says, Les, I read this afternoon, and it didn't mean a thing like when you read it. Well, maybe I do have a unique way of reading. So bear with me, because I see no other way to teach a book like Ruth, because there aren't a lot of things that I can go and chase other references. It's just simply a verse-by-verse love story. But yet we do want to get the impact of how God was in control of everything to bring about a redemption that would fit with the redemption then of Revelation chapter 5. That's my whole purpose that I'm trying to bring up. All right, so go back with me now in chapter 2. Jerry's already got chapter 3 up there, and that's well and good. We'll be there in a minute. But let's come back to chapter 2 and verse 19. And Ruth has now come home to the house of Naomi at the end of the day up there in Bethlehem. And naturally, I mean, these people are just as normal and human as we are. What's the first question she asks Ruth? Well, how'd it go today? Isn't that about right? Sure. How did it go today, Ruth? Did you have a good day? See? Verse 19, and her mother-in-law said, where hast thou gleaned today? And where workest thou? Blessed be he that did take knowledge of thee. And she showed her mother-in-law with whom she had worked and said, the man's name with whom I worked or wrought in the King James is Boaz. Well, that didn't mean anything to Ruth. She didn't know of any particular connection, but all the lights came on and the bells rang for Naomi, see? And Naomi said, blessed be he of the Lord, who hath not left off his kindness to the living and to the dead. What's she making reference to? The family tree. Her dead husband, her dead sons, who were all part and parcel of that inheritance, that piece of ground that's laying there mortgaged. And Naomi said, the man is what? Next of kin. Hallelujah, Ruth, this means something. This is just the guy that we need. He's wealthy. He's next of kin. He's one of our kinsmen. He's going to be a kinsman redeemer. All right, verse 21. So Ruth the Moabitess said, well, he said unto me also, thou shalt stay fast by my young men until they have ended all my heart. In other words, pick up the conversation. Now, you got to read between the lines. Here are these two women, the mother-in-law and her young daughter-in-law, are rehearsing the events of the day, and here she's come home with an unusual amount of grain for just being a gleaner. And so, why? How come? Well, the man told me. I didn't even have to wait for the harvesters. I could take part of theirs. And so Naomi is just ecstatic. I'm sure she is. See? Verse 22, so Naomi said unto Ruth, her daughter-in-law, it's good, my daughter. It is good that thou shalt go out with his maidens, and that they meet thee not in any other field. What's she telling her? You stay on Boaz's field, and don't you wander anyplace else. Because, hey, things are happening here. God is in control, see? And so now Naomi becomes what? Cupid. Naomi becomes what we call Cupid. She's going to make sure that Ruth does everything right so that we can see this consummation of a kinsman redeemer marrying this girl. So don't put anything immoral in here. Everything is according to custom, and everything is in righteousness, because these are two people that God is going to use for his purposes. All right. Verse 1, chapter 3. Then Naomi, the mother-in-law, said unto her, my daughter, shall I not seek rest for thee, that it may be well with thee? And now is not Boaz of our kindred, he's our next of kin, with whose maidens thou wast, in other words, whose maidens you've been working with? Now, see, Naomi knows the whole process. Ruth is just a young, innocent girl, fresh out of a foreign country. She doesn't know the process of harvest time, but Naomi does. And look what happens next. Behold, he winnoweth barley tonight in the threshing floor. Now, again, you got to know some of your ancient history. What was the threshing floor? Well, it was a flat, probably level piece of property, and it probably was on a rather high elevation, because when you winnow grain, as they did in antiquity, they'd probably beat it and beat it to get all the chaff loosened. So in order to winnow it, then what do? They pick it up in a container, and they pour it out and let the wind blow the chaff aside, and the grain falls straight down. That's what you call winnowing. Now, I've made comment this before. If you go through wheat country at harvest time, that old combine is just spewing out all the trash out the back. But where's the grain? Up in the tank. Well, what's happened? They've separated all the straw and the chaff and the dust, and the pure wheat is up in the tank. Well, all right, now they're doing it in antiquity by just holding it up high and pouring the grain and let the wind blow the chaff. All right, now Naomi knows all about this. So she said, they usually do this at night. Now, I did some research on this, and the reason they did it at night was not only to escape the heat, but there was usually a little more breeze. It wouldn't be that stifling stillness. So nighttime was when they could pick up some breeze. So she says, now you get back to the threshing floor, because that's where Boaz will be tonight. See? All right, verse 3. Now, don't tell me she's not playing Cupid. Wash thyself. My goodness, you've been sweating all day. Now, you get yourself all cleaned up, and you get perfumed, and you get to where you're attractive to Boaz. All right, wash thyself, therefore, anoint thee, put thy raiment, in other words, the best clothes that you've got, and get thee down to the threshing floor. But make not thyself known to the man. Don't let Boaz know. Don't come in with a big bluster. Just sort of slip in quietly. And don't make yourself known. Don't let him even be aware that you're there until he's finished his evening meal. Now verse 4. And it shall be when he lieth down. Now there again, what do you suppose was the custom? After they've been winnowing grain and they've had a long day even overseeing the servants and stuff, everybody needs some rest. And so they would just simply lay down and sleep up there on the threshing floor. And so again, Naomi knows all this. Now she said, Boaz will probably just lay down and sleep up there at the threshing floor without taking time to go home. And thou shalt go in, verse 4, uncover his feet and lay thee down, and he will tell thee what thou shalt do. And so she said unto her, all that thou sayest I will do. And so she went down to the threshing floor, did according to all that her mother-in-law had instructed her. And when Boaz had eaten and drunk, his heart was merry, he went to lie down at the end of the heap of grain. In other words, after he had finished that much of a day's work. And she came softly, uncovered his feet, just exactly like Naomi told her to do, and she laid down. And it came to pass at midnight that the man was afraid. Evidently, the Lord had done something to probably shake him awake. And he turned himself, and behold, a woman lay at his feet. Verse 9. Who art thou? Well, now you got to remember, in antiquity, they had more darkness than we have. And it was probably almost pitch dark. And he doesn't know who is at his feet. And so he says, who art thou? And she answered, I am Ruth, thy handmaid. Spread therefore thy skirt over thy handmaid, for thou art a near kinsman. Now there again, you go back into antiquity, and some of the customs of Israel was just exactly this, that the maid would have her suitor just more or less cover her, like with a piece of what we would today probably call a quilt or something. And so she says, spread your skirt over thy handmaid, for thou art a near kinsman. And he said, blessed be thou of the Lord, my daughter, for thou hast showed more kindness in the latter end than at the beginning, inasmuch that thou hast followest not the young men, whether they were poor or rich. So what has Boaz realized? That this girl isn't just looking at that which was the most attractive or that which would satisfy the desires of a young girl. But even though Boaz was somewhat older, she was simply following the instructions of her mother-in-law, and her mother-in-law has only got one thing in mind, and what is it? Get that mortgage paid off. We want that mortgage paid off, and he's the only one that can do it. And so all of this, yes, it was some conniving. But listen, have other characters in God's program connived? Well, I reckon they did. What about Isaac and Esau? My, if anybody ever connived to get something done, Rebekah did. You remember how she helped Jacob get covered up with animal skins so that poor old Isaac would be deceived? And so evidently it was all in God's divine purposes, even though we may not consider it apropos. But always remember, this is God at work. And after the fact, we can see why everything played out the way it did. All right, verse 11. Now, my daughter, fear not. I will do to thee all that thou requirest. In other words, with regard to that mortgage. Now don't get the immoral aspect. Keep that out of your mind. We're dealing with a piece of property that has to be paid off with money. Okay? And he said, I will do to thee all that thou requirest, for all the city of my people doth know thou art a virtuous woman. And Boaz, in so many words, is saying, and I'm not going to do anything to change that. So you got nothing to fear. Now verse 12, and now it is true that I am thy near or next of kin. Howbeit, oh now here there's always got to be a monkey wrench. Howbeit there is a kinsman that is what? Nearer than I. Oh, I'll bet the poor girl's heart almost stopped. There was another gentleman who was actually a closer relative even than Boaz. Now, according to Israeli law of the inheritance and everything, what did they have to do? They had to give this guy first chance on the property. Well, that's enough to scare anybody, isn't it? And so Boaz knows this, and so he tells her, there's someone else that has to have first chance at this buying off your mortgage. All right, verse 13. Well, he doesn't send her home. We're going to continue on the premise that we're going to get this done, see? Tarry this night, and it shall be in the morning that he will perform unto thee the part of a kinsman. Now, in straight English, what's Boaz saying? Well, let's just rest, sleep, and in the morning we'll approach this fellow who is a closer next of kin than I am and see if he wants to pay off the mortgage. That's literally what he's saying. Let's just wait until morning, and we will approach him and see if he will do the part of a kinsman. All right, so he says, lie down until the morning. Verse 14, so she laid at his feet until the morning. She rose up before one could know another. In other words, what? Still dark. And he said, let it not be known that a woman came to the threshing floor. And he also said, bring the veil that thou hast upon thee and hold it. In other words, it was like a piece of cloth, or I suppose today I liken it to an apron. My, how many of you have seen women take that apron, put a knot in the end of it, and fill it up with apples and whatever? My, those of you who are older, you remember that. All right, this is basically what he's saying. He said, now, Ruth, you take that piece of cloth you've got. We're going to just make a basket. And he fills it with what? Grain, because that was the staff of life in that day, see? And so he measured in 6 measures of barley. That was a pretty good chunk of grain that she had to carry home in what then became a knapsack, see? And so now then, verse 15, when she held it, he measured 6 measures of the barley and laid it on her, and she went into the city, or into Bethlehem, to the home of Naomi. All right, she gets, now you got to read between the lines. I'm always stressing that. Now she gets home to Naomi, and Ruth says to Naomi, these 6 measures of barley he gave me. For he said to me, no, not empty to your mother-in-law. And then she said, sit still, my daughter, until thou know how the matter will fall. Well, in plain English, what's she saying? Let's just play it cool. Let's not do anything rash. Let's just see how all this works out. Now, see, what I try to bring in here is that these people, now this is about 1500 B.C. This is about 500 years before King David. Were they any different than we are today? Not one bit. These two women are just as concerned of what's going to happen to their future with regard to that piece of ground, because they could end up with a fairly decent life, or they could end up continuing on poor as church mice. And so they are concerned. But Naomi is telling Ruth in so many words, let's play it cool now, Ruth. Let's not do anything rash or foolish that we lose it. All right? So she said, sit still, verse 18, until thou know how the matter will fall, for the man will not be unrest until he has finished the thing today. Now again, the human element. What do you suppose is churning in the heart of Boaz? Oh, I hope that guy doesn't take up the opportunity. I hope that other fellow won't buy the mortgage, because he wants to have the opportunity of not only buying the mortgage, but he's got Ruth on his mind. Don't think he hasn't. And so, verse 1 now of chapter 4. Then went Boaz up to the gate. Now, what does that mean? Well, in Old Testament language, it means that that's where the city fathers would gather, at the city gate. Now, if you go to the ancient city of Corinth, it was at the Bema seat. It was an elevated place, and the city fathers would hold council. All right, now, in Israel's antiquity then, to have the men at the gate meant that that was the more or less the city fathers and the guys that were more or less in control of the community's welfare. So Boaz goes up to the gate, sat down, and behold, the very man he wants to deal with comes along. Now again, what is that? Hey, that's the God thing. It's that moment of divine appointment. Here comes just exactly the guy they're waiting for. And so the kinsman of whom Boaz spake, that is, to Ruth, came by, unto whom he said, ho. Today we'd say what? Hey. come here. I got something I want to talk to you about. So this other next of kinsmen turns aside. He sits down. Verse 2. Boaz immediately fills what was required to make this kind of an agreement for witnesses and so forth. So he took 10 men of the elders of the city and said, sit down. And they did. They sat down. They knew that there was something that was going to be conducted that was of importance. Verse 2, so he took the 10 men of the elders of the city and said, sit down. They sat down, and he said unto the kinsmen of Naomi, Naomi that is come again out of the country of Moab selleth a parcel of land which was our brother Elimelech's. I thought to advertise or to let you know, and I'm telling you, buy it before the inhabitants and before the elders of my people. If you want to redeem it, then redeem it. You've got dibs on this thing. You have got first right by virtue of your relationship with Naomi. Now, if you want this piece of property, buy it. If you don't, tell me so. See? If thou wilt redeem it, verse 4, redeem it. But if thou wilt not redeem it, then tell me that I may know, for there is none to redeem it besides thee, and I am after thee. And he said, I will redeem it. All right, then said Boaz, what day thou buyest the field of the hand of Naomi, thou must buy also of Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of the dead, to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance. Now, all of a sudden, everything changes. Verse 6, according to the laws of redemption, this guy couldn't do it. So he loses out. All right, read it. And the first kinsman said, I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I mar my own inheritance. Now, according to the laws of Israel, and I haven't got time to go into all that, but they recognize that this first next of kin, for whatever relationship he had other than Naomi, he could not redeem it. So he says, redeem thou my right to thyself, for I cannot redeem it. Now that opens the door for Boaz. Now this was the manner in former time in Israel concerning redeeming and concerning changing, for to conform all things, a man plucked off his shoe. Now this is the way they consummated these things legally. So he plucked off his shoe and gave it to his neighbor, and this was a testimony in Israel. Therefore the kinsman said unto Boaz, buy it for yourself. And so he drew off his shoe, and Boaz said to the elders and to all the people, you are witnesses this day that I have bought all that was Elimelech's and all that was Chilion's and Malion's of the hand of Naomi. Moreover, Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of Malon, have I purchased to be a what? To be a wife. See? So everything is falling in place. And I have purchased to be my wife, to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance, that the name of the dead be not cut off from among his brethren and from the gate of his palace. You are witnesses this day. Now verse 11, we've got to do this quickly. And all the people that were in the gate and the elders said, we're witnesses. The Lord make the woman that is come into thy house like Rachel and like Leah, which two did build the house of Israel, and do thou worthily in Ephratah, and be famous in Bethlehem, and let thy house be like the house of Phares, whom Tamar bare unto Judah. Oh, now wait a minute. Here is what gets interesting in the genealogy of Christ. Is it just a genealogy of the elite? Is it just a genealogy of the noble? No. Because what was Tamar? What was Tamar? Come on, you don't want to say it, do you? She was a prostitute. And she had a child by Jacob, who went in when he certainly shouldn't have. But she ends up in the genealogy, see? All right, and these people are aware of that. And they said, well, let Ruth be in the same vein. Sure, she's a Moabitess. But here by divine appointment, she has come in, and she's going to be a part of this lineage of Israel. Now, they didn't know ahead. They were just looking at what had gone in the past, see? That's why they said, let thy house be like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bare unto Judah. I said Jacob, I'm sorry, Judah. Of the seed which the Lord shall give thee of this young woman. So Boaz took Ruth, and she was his wife, went in unto her, and the Lord gave her conception, and she bare a son. And when the women said unto Naomi, behold, or blessed be the Lord which hath not left thee of this day without a kinsman, that his name may be famous in Israel, and he shall be unto thee a restorer of thy life. See, now this is so where Naomi is coming in. And a nourisher of thine old age, for thy daughter-in-law who loveth thee, which is better to thee than seven sons, hath borne him. Now what did this do for Naomi? Why, it put her in a place of ease for the rest of her days. Instead of being poverty-stricken, she can now live with a certain amount of wealth. But the important thing is, what does this do with Ruth? It puts her right in the genealogy of Jesus Christ. All right, I got a minute time. Come up with me to Matthew chapter 1. And this is the beauty of Scripture. This is our sovereign God. This is why I make no apology for proclaiming who he is and what he is. He's in control of everything, even the little details. Even the little details by making the first next of kin unable to redeem. But the one who was meant to have it is going to get it. You got Matthew chapter 1? And for sake of time, I'm going to bring you all the way down to verse 5 in the genealogy that began back there with Abraham. Now verse 5, and Salmon begat Boaz of Rahab. And what was Rahab? The woman on the wall at Jericho. And Boaz begat Obed. And who was the mother of Obed? Ruth. And so there she sits in the genealogy of our Lord Jesus Christ. Oy, but what was the picture that we tied in? Christ is going to redeem planet Earth as a next of kin, and he had the power and the wherewithal and the wealth of heaven to pay off the mortgage held by Satan.
Thank you for watching Through the Bible with Les Feldick. Through the Bible is a partner-supported ministry. If this program has been a help to your study of the Scriptures and you'd like to see others enjoy the teaching, your support would be greatly appreciated. Write to us at Les Feldick Ministries, 30706 West Lona Valley Road, Kinta, Oklahoma, 74552. Or call 1-800-369-7856. Remember, all programs are available in printed form, audio cassette, and videotape. Be sure to tune in next time to Through the Bible with Les Feldick.